It's an update.
Okay, so I'll be honest. I'm not sure that Panavice is still selling Panavices. And so we had to update this Lady Ada toolkit. And I figured now's a good time to make a couple updates. So we've swapped out the original Panavice vice, which, believe me, I loved it. But like I said, we ordered them many months ago and they've not arrived. And it's not clear when they will arrive.
If you go to Panavice right now, it's at that stage where there's someone who's not renewing the SSL certification and it's not HTTPS anymore. That's usually not a good sign.
Yeah. Anyways,
we'll find out more and let you know.
So we have the Pros Kit vice, which is a very good vice. And we swapped, instead of having a little packet of components, we now give you a full parts pal. So you get way more components, cables, buttons, LEDs. You get the breadboard, you get the tools. So I think it's a really great update. Everything is better and it's the same price.
You could tell what year it is based on what's available in the Lady Ada toolkit. Welcome to 2025. Okay, next up.
Next up, we don't have a demo for this because I ran out of time, but this is the Charlie Plex bonnet, but in red. And I also grabbed the wrong one when I left the office. So I'm going to show it in blue and we're going to pretend it's red.
Oh, you know, I bet there's some people who, if they see blue, they only see...
If you're colorblind in the right way, this will... This
yeah,
will
be you fun. Know what I didn't do? I don't think I did the overhead.
So okay.
Okay, there you go.
So it's 8x16 LEDs controlled by an IS-31FL. It normally would plug into a Raspberry Pi. I'm not doing that right now because I didn't want to wait for the Raspberry Pi to boot. I just connected up to a Cutie Pie instead. But you get full 8-bit color, so 8-bit PWM on all of the LEDs. So you can do like fun animations. It's monochromatic, but you get dimmed LEDs. And they're all constant current and they look really good. Now available in red.
Okie dokie. Next up.
Next up, we have this board. I do want to show it this way. This is from Hard Stuff. It's a Pico to Pi Hat. So what's interesting about this is it lets you convert the classic Raspberry Pi Pico into a Raspberry Pi Zero layout. And there's a couple of pros and cons with this, but there's a lot of boards that are coming out, not only just RP2040 or RP2350, like the Pico and the Pico 2, but also there's some ESP boards and stuff that come out in the same package slash layout as the Pico. So you can solder it on top.
Yeah.
So you do have to do some soldering, and then you can plug in a bonnet. So actually, I did a little demo. Let's see if it boots up. Okay. So on the overhead. Okay. So this is Pico's running CircuitPython, and I plugged the bonnet in, and it's displaying the temperature and humidity on the OLED, but it's on a Pico. But you're using like the OLED bonnet. So that's kind of cool. I will say one thing I learned, you know, hopefully they'll fix in the next version, is they don't have I2C pull-up resistors on the breakout. And you do need those to connect to most Raspberry Pi hats and bonnets because they assume that you have the pull-ups on the Raspberry Pi that would be plugged into. So in this case, I'm taking advantage of, you know, the sensor has I2C pull-ups on it. But if you're wondering why I2C isn't working, you'll need to solder on resistors somehow underneath the board or like on the Pico from GPIO 2 and 3, I think, to 3.3 volts. Just something to watch out for. I made a note on the product page as well. But, you know, it's kind of cute because it's like you can, you know, you can plug in boards that are designed for the Raspberry Pi and the pins almost map one to one.
All right. Next up, you had said it was okay for me to put one picture of this, and then what I did was I put that we have a bunch of different types and then like the close-ups.
Yeah, so we have this like rippable ribbon, and I use this a lot, and it's just like ribbon cable. It's silicone coated, so it's very soft and it's very flexible. So it's really good for wearables. And we stocked this, I think, in like 30 gauge, but I wanted some thicker gauges, so now we have it in 20 and 24. And I think, if you go to the new product,
go
to the browser.
Yeah.
And then go to new. Yeah. So then
I'm going to go.
Can you share that?
Yeah. I'm going to do that right now.
Okay. So they're 1 meter long and they're now available in 20 and then scroll up. 22, 24, and 26 gauge. So I think we had 28 or 30 gauge. Now we have thicker cables. I was going to do a project and it had NeoPixels in it, and I wanted thicker wires for power. It's going to be more expensive the thicker the gauge because there's more copper inside. But what's nice is there, you know, no matter what number of wires you need, just rip them off and you know, you'll be able to use that number, and then you can cut them any length you want.
All right, the star of the show tonight, besides you, Lady Ada, our team at Adafruit, all the folks in the community, and everyone trying to figure out what their HTS codes are. Shout out. Here it is. What is this?
This is the CC Fixer, a product we wish we didn't have to make.
The Fixer.
But we actually needed this in-house because I needed it for a couple products that I purchased that don't have the USB CC pins. And so when you try to charge them from a USB power delivery plug or from a computer like a Mac especially, direct from a USB-C port, they won't power or charge or sync because they're not providing the 5 volts. And that's because the people who designed the board forgot to put the two 5.1K resistors on there. And this kind of drives me nuts because it works on some computers, not others. It's like inconsistent. Like my, you know, I always use a A to C converter cable, so I don't notice, but then I give it to you and you're using a MacBook, it doesn't function anymore. So what this board does, and I'm showing it with a little like USB PD analyzer, is it will signal, I want 5 volts up to 2-3 amps. There's a little green LED to let you know, and it just fits on the end of the cable or connector. It just goes in the middle, and it will just trick it into always providing 5 volts. So you don't have to think about it. You don't have to worry about it. So have one of these around, and then, you know, we just added to the charging cable for the devices that we need to charge.
Trick it real good. Put this on or in your special cable box, because when you're going through your cable, trying to figure out, is it the cable, is it the device, whatever, have one of these, figure it out. We have a baby monitor.
Yeah, because it'll fix it. I have a bunch of devices, low-cost electronics that just, they screwed this up.
Yeah, and you know, let me just, before we just get off this here, so we don't want to have our baby stuff on the internet. So we have one that's not on the internet, but it transmits, you know. And unfortunately, I have to always remember that it doesn't like other USB cables that are more common. So I have to have a special one.
Yeah.
And now I have this and I can use it for anyone. It's very handy.
Yeah, and you can use this for sync or charging. Like it has the D plus and D minus lines come through.
Okay, and they want to know, is the data line connected?
Yes, the data lines are connected, but the CC lines are missed, you know, they're pulled out.
They're under our control.
They're done up right. So you get, you know, it's for 5 volt USB 2.0. Obviously, if you're using something that uses the sideband pins or the high speed TX pins, you're not going to have this issue because if they are using those, you did it properly. This is for those like low cost things that have USB-C ports.
Like baby monitors that aren't on the internet. That's new products.
Yep.